Lord Jesus Christ saith, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy upon us. not to the flesh, to love according to the flesh, for if you love according to the flesh, you will die. But the Spirit will be God to death, the deeds of the body will life. All who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the Spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the Spirit of sonship, when we cry, Abba Father, He is the Spirit Himself bringing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provide this offer with Him in order that we may also be glorified. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sent to the sea, and great crowds gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat there, and the whole crowd stood on the beach, and he told them many things in parables, saying, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell among a path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they had not much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depths of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell upon thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them out. Other seeds fell on good soil, and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let them hear. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, The evil one comes and snatches away what is sowed in this heart. This is what was sown among the path. As for what was sown around what rocky ground, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. And when tribulations and persecutions arise on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is he who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the delight in riches choke the word and proves unfaithful. As far as what was sown on good soil, this is he who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, in another 30. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O
say, you mean you own
that certain grocery stores that now refuse to wipe their baskets are still good places to go, and on and on and on and on. And I can honestly tell you that you are in the safe. Why Pastor Dan or the bridge would give anything to have a mask, or gloves, or hand sanitizer. So all of my frustrations don't matter. My frustrations are minimal. And when we're frustrated, it doesn't mean that we have to feel guilty. Put differently, I don't feel guilty that I'm as blessed as I am in my life. I don't feel guilty about that. And the reason I don't is because I know I'm responsible for it. Everything I have is a gift from God, and that's the same with you. Does that mean he doesn't love other people? No. No, it doesn't mean that at all. But what it does mean is a couple of things. Every morning, we have the opportunity to say yes to Jesus or no to Jesus. You ever thought about that? Every morning, we get to say yes to Jesus or no to Jesus. And I can remember how many times I've been under the bridges praying with people. And they said yes to Jesus. But they're oftentimes the most content people I've ever met. Even though that may not sound right to you, I remember one time a man saying to me how blessed he was because he had found an empty dumpster the night before to sleep in instead of one that was filled with debris like he usually has to sleep in. Think about that. Yesterday, somebody told me they had a lumpy bed. I have to admit, I never seem like I am being unconcerned or uncaring when somebody tells me that. Because I don't want to say, yeah, but if you only knew what it was like to sleep in a dumpster, I mean, how's that going to help? So I'm not going to make anybody feel guilty, because I can't. Remember, we all choose to feel guilty, right? That's a choice we have. You can choose to feel guilty about something. You can choose not to. But let me just say this. Don't ever feel guilty about the blessings and the gifts that God's given you. Well, why does he give us these gifts? So that I can go under the bridge and hand something to Father Andy over there, who can then make sure that they can get a meal or they can find a place to stay. But he is dependent upon us doing that. Now, not stewardship. But being brought up knowing that you're supposed to give 10% of everything you have to the Lord's work, I just oftentimes think about all of the problems people are having right now that could be resolved by Christians who simply would make it all happen. I wish that priest, before he lost his $1 million and said that to me, I would have told him what to do in advance. I would have asked him to invest in some more people. Then he wouldn't have to worry about what happened to his $1 million because he would have invested it there. Sometimes when we invest in the future and we get upset about the fact that we've lost X amount of money, about where we could have invested it in terms of people. But it's extremely pondering. But it's so easy in the world. And that's what the gospel is about for today, because I am a frustrated gardener. No, I'm not a frustrated gardener. I'm a lousy gardener. I mean, there's a difference. I should be frustrated gardener. But what that means is, for reason, I have a brown thumb. Green thumbs. And I've seen all these wonderful things you planted and how wonderful they all look. And I simply cannot tell you that I'm gifted in that regard. But you notice what happened with the seed. Did you look at that in the gospel for today? Okay. If you're looking carefully at the gospel for today, what have you figured out? Some people don't know how to plant seed. I don't know about you, but I've discovered, on the other hand, why I'm not anyone looked at a concrete sidewalk and threw seeds on top of it. That's not exactly what we're talking about. What we're talking about is they didn't care enough to find out what was under that little bit of dirt that was sitting on top of what the problem was, and breaking up the concrete, or the stone, I should say, because that's what these people were, with hammers were doing when I sat down with them and asked them to hand me a hammer. They were hammering on that little bit of soil, up the stone, so that they could plant something. Years later, I happened to be in Arizona, and somebody was telling me what a beautiful front yard they had. Well, I was looking forward to it. When I got there, I've never seen so many stones in front of a house in my entire life. But they were really excited about it, because they said they can't grow grass there. So the next thing that happens, they said, what do you think about the tree? I was like, it's nice. You know, nothing to write home about. But the reason they liked it is because they paid $300 to plant it. Because they had to pay somebody to come in and break the caliche to get down to the dirt so they could plant trees. Now, I don't know about you, but that would probably want to put me in a position reconsidering grass in my front yard for trees. But that meant they had to take extra work to plant something. Now, the other one is really strange to me, is putting the soil down, because you understand, when the seeds were put on something that is only that much dirt, somebody eventually will enjoy those seeds, won't they? They're called birds. So that's what that part's about. So they're probably saying, these are the nicest human beings I've ever met. They're always putting out bird seed for me. Now the next one comes along, of course, and I want you to look at the problem here with all the briar, all of the thorns, all those branches. Well, wouldn't you think, is this reasonable? If those briars are growing, if I just plant seed here, they're going to take off too. The reason they're going to take off is because the briars needed it, right? Yeah. Except that when what we planted there started to come up, all the briars started choking it. It's dead. And it says that's what happens when you get caught up in the world. Now, what does that mean, getting caught up in the world? Well, for everybody else, it's just a little bit different. Nobody has the same story. But many times it means just listening to an urge or an impulse that really isn't from God. But remember, since all the other kids are doing it, it must be okay. Of course, what happens is I have to go back to my book of Alberta Pritchard Ackerman sayings in order for any of this to make sense. And Alberta Pritchard Ackerman would say, along with some of your folk, well, if everybody jumped off the bridge, would you jump off too? Right? Remember those? Okay, that being said, many people today function as if they can get away with something because everybody else is doing it. That's right. But that's what Jesus is talking about. So we need to look carefully at what the gospel means, because you do get it, don't you? And he has now explained this to everybody. Is that the end of the story in the gospel for today? No, because Jesus is looking at them, and what does he see? Confused faces, body language, expressions like this, huh? Because you understand, not everybody got Jesus' parables. They didn't always understand it. And today we don't get a lot of them because we don't know, for example, about the soil issue I just explained to you. Now when you start thinking about what was going on in the time of Jesus,
parables make total sense, but still they didn't get it. So what does he do in the second half of the gospel today? He explains it. Now, that's pretty a remarkable thing, because in some of the other parables, you need to figure it out for yourself. But in today's gospel and parable, you get Jesus' explanation. So just for a moment, here's what I want us to do, because we're all frustrated about something. You know, no air conditioning, whoopee-doo. You know, I mean, I've lived in places where it's 100 degrees and my head hanging out the window with a fan blowing. I mean, you know, am I so spoiled that I can't live without one? Or the fact that, oh darn, that door wouldn't open. And we couldn't get out that door, so Kevin had to do some creative work to get that door to open. I mean, I don't know, the list goes, oh, we need to put this out, got to get that out, and so on. During the pandemic, there are many people having to buy jobs. And most of the time, really good at it. And some of the time, we get frustrated. But what is really beautiful about living in a Christian community is that we get a little bit frustrated. Don't worry about it, because next week it's your turn to be frustrated. And I'll be there for you. I'll hold you up. So, don't sweat the small stuff. Today we're going to focus on the big stuff. Now, you're going to see. Generally, a baptism is very much more participative, but we are doing social distancing, and you're going to notice a few things I've today. They're going to be really excited with us, and the reason for that is they don't use their thumbs typically to anoint on the forehead, and we're not doing that either. We have holy paintbrushes that I have blessed, and that's what we use for the anointings. Put differently, we don't ignore what can be done. We go back to history and find out what has been done. Keep in mind, folks, this is not the first epidemic in history. This is not the first time that people have had to be cautious. This is not the first time that people have had to keep appropriate social distance. The problem with the world we live in today, since it's the first time for me, but go back and read history. How did they do it? What did they do? Why did they do it the way they did it? Why did bishops wear gauntlets? Just to keep his hands warm? Think about it. And on you will discover that you are a part of a tradition of Holy Mother Church where we have over 2,000 years worth of experience. So if you get a little bored, go back and read what the saints said it was like when they had to quarantine, when they had to isolate, when they had to be away from the community. Or, let's check this one out. There was only one group that didn't have to worry about social distancing in the Bible. There's only one group that never had to worry about a number of matters regarding contact. Figure it out? Well, turn back. Here was a very wealthy Jew. Here was a non-observant Jew, middle class. Here was a low-class person, beggar. I don't like using classes, but for the sake of the argument. Here was somebody whose skin color was darker. Here's one whose skin color was lighter. Here's another one who spoke with a Galilean accent. These are not people who would ever hung out together until they were all determined to have leprosy. And the moment they were determined to have leprosy, they all lived together. They would have never spent any time together. They would have never invited each other to their social events or their parties. None of it. But now they were lepers. they got so far, the rest of the people, you know what they were obliged to say? They had to shout at the top of their lungs, unclean. So that nobody would get close to them. Now mind you, what would it be like shouting from here up to the parish house and seeing your daughter and saying, I'm so happy you just turned 13. I'm so happy, you say to somebody who's over on the hillside over there, so happy to see my grandchild for the first time. Never be hugged, never be kissed, never be touched. Never be told how sweet they were when they weren't well. So I want you today to think about every one of your frustrations. Everything that has annoyed you today or yesterday. Everything that you can say, oh, you've got to be kidding. I want you to think about all of that. Maybe creative conversations you had in your household today. Or you'll have this afternoon. But what would happen if one of you were proclaimed a leper today? Wouldn't you give anything to have that frustration again? Wouldn't you have love to be able to open a door but you can't touch them? Never mind one that's stuck. Never mind a clock that gave you one time other than another time because you won't need that clock. There is no time with a leper. Except waiting for death. So let's put life into perspective right now, folks. Let's put it into perspective. Anytime you're annoyed, frustrated, angry, whatever, don't be silly enough to say somebody's worse off than I am, because that just will head you towards guilt. But rather take a moment and thank God for what you have this very second. So let's try it out. I want everybody right now, frustrated, upset, sense of loss, life isn't normal. Okay, I want you to take a deep breath and think about it for a moment. You are still alive. If you're still alive, you have potential. You have potential to touch another life. You have potential to be able to tell Jesus' story about today. You have the potential to save a life by giving them the good news of Jesus Christ. And you know what else? Sophie. You're never going to believe this, dear. But today you're going to be reborn.
Yep.
I know it. Today you're going to be reborn. And guess what, godparents? Like the instruction I had for you, she can't ever forget it. That's your job. And remember, you're going to be presenting her so she can make her first Holy Communion. And then you're going to be presenting her so that she can be confirmed. And then you're going to make sure, although she won't have to do it this afternoon, that she has, that she learns how to say the Lord's Prayer, the Ten Commandments, and the Apostles' Creed. That's the job every godparent has. Not bad if you think about it, because in exchange you get a lot of cuddle time. Yeah, so there's a good trade-off here. But that's what's expected of all godparents. That's what's expected. Now back to my frustration. You ready for it? You have to decide whether it's appropriate. It's when I discovered that godparents don't do that. That makes me sad. Because it means that many of the problems that young people are dealing with today, some of it could have been avoided if the godparents had just been godparents. Now, in the tradition out of which you come, rich and zealous, it's like in my wife's Italian family, Padre e Compadre. See? And also in the Spanish language. Padre, pero madrina y padrino. See? But you notice in those words what it does? It uses kind of like a little mom and a little dad. So that means that you're supposed to be little moms and little dads. That's what godparents are. The problem with the English language, once again, is we don't have a comparable term. What we have is godparent, and while we say parent of God, it's not as well defined. That until not long ago, the reason godparents were selected was because in the event of the death of the parents, you didn't need to have any directives. You didn't need to have a will. Godparents automatically, that's why they were asked. So today, for those of you who are godparents, would you all please pray for your godchildren? For all of you who still have godparents, would you pray for them? And today I ask you to pray for somebody kind of special to me. And that is my wife's sweet and lovely cousin, Sylvia, who died this week. She and Joe are the same age. They both came up having breast cancer. And a princess, was your daughter the king. All of your sins have been washed away, even though from what I've observed this morning, there isn't much of that. But original sin is inevitable, by the way, Joel. I mean, it's there. Eventual sin is inevitable. But also, you become an inheritor of eternal life. Now, why anybody would not want to be baptized or make sure that your family is baptized, I don't know. Because if somebody told me I had an inheritance in coming, it's going to come sometime, I want to know where I sign up. But today, you get to sign up for your inheritance, love. Later on, if they don't do their job, you can point that out to your parents and your godparents, though I have no doubts. Today, I want you to renew your own baptismal promises, friends, because the culture in which we live today, the world in which we live today, there's no guarantee that you're going to wake up tomorrow. So check in your inheritance first. And if you lose $1 million in this world, guess what? You can't take it. In the name of the Father and of the Son.
Amen.
People say, why do you change clothes and colors so often? Well, it's because green is not the color that we wear for baptisms, nor is it the color that we wear for renunciations. Because we do exorcisms in the church. Did you know that? In fact, in just a moment, with the oil of catechumen, that means that what we are doing is we're asking everybody here to renounce their sins. We're also asking godparents and the parents to renounce on behalf of Sophie. Now, every now and then somebody will say, shouldn't you wait until the person's old enough to say that for themselves? Let me tell you why I don't believe that. If I waited until my children were old enough to tell me that what they wanted to eat or they needed to go to the doctors, we would have been in deep trouble. And so what that means is we adults have to make decisions for our children just to keep them healthy. And today you're stepping forward to make sure she's healthy.
Beloved in the Lord, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our heavenly sacrament of holy baptism. By way of person, Sophie, is to be a member, made member of Christ's body, the Church. By the working of this holy sacrament, ordained by Christ himself, Sophie will die to sin and be raised to the newness of life, receiving the fullness of God's grace, while she may faithfully serve him all the days of her life.
The candidate for holy baptism will now be presented. Take heed that this child whom thou dost present be brought up in the Christian faith and life, learn the creed, the Lord's Prayer, and the Ten Commandments, and all other things with it which a Christian ought to know and believe to his soul's health. Wilt thou by thy prayers and witness help this child to grow into the full stature of Christ, and to take heed that this child, so soon as sufficiently instructed, be brought to the bishop to be confirmed by him.
I will, by God's help.
The renunciations which you are making on her behalf. Dost thou renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Dost thou renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce
all sinful desires that draw thee from the love of God.
I renounce them all.
With the oil of salvation in Christ Jesus our Lord, that thou mayest have eternal life. Dost thou turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as thy Savior? Dost thou put thy whole trust in his grace and love? Dost thou promise to follow and obey him as thy Lord and Master? Wilt thee, ye who witness these vows, do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ?
We will.
Dearly beloved, let us join with those who are now committing themselves to Christ Jesus and here renew our own baptismal covenant. Dost thou believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Dost thou believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and he sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead.
Dost thou believe in God the Holy Ghost?
I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Wilt thou continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, by God's help.
Wilt thou persevere in resisting evil? And whenever thou dost fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord.
I will, by God's help.
Wilt thou proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ Jesus?
I will, by God's help.
Wilt thou seek and serve Christ and all men, loving thy neighbor as thyself?
I will, by God's help.
Wilt thou strive for and peace among all men, and respect the dignity of every person.
I will, by God's help.
Dearly beloved, for as much as our Savior Jesus Christ said, no one can enter into the kingdom of God except he be regenerate and born anew of water and of the Holy Ghost, I beseech you to call upon God the Father through our Lord Jesus Christ, that of his bounteous mercy he will grant to thee, this person, that which by nature she cannot have, that she may be baptized in the Holy Ghost and received into Christ's holy church to be made a living member of the saints.
Deliver her, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open her up to thy grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill her with thy holy and life-giving spirit. Faith and communion of thy holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach her in the power of the Holy Ghost.
Lord,
send her into the world in faithful witness to thine abounding love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring her to the fullness of thy peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For as baptism is never done in green vestments, obviously, but in white. Who need and the helper of all who flee to thee for succor, the life of those who believe and the resurrection of the dead. We call upon thee for this thy daughter, that she coming into thy holy baptism may receive remission, spiritually regenerated, receive her promised by ask and ye life.
Amen.
Give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right.
water over which thy Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation, through which thou didst lead the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise, in which thy Son Jesus Christ received the baptism of John and the anointing of the Holy Ghost, being manifested thereby as the Messiah, the Christ who leadeth us through his precious death and mighty resurrection from the body of sin unto life everlasting. We give thee thanks, O Father, for the water of baptism in which we are buried with Christ in his death, by which we partake of his resurrection, through which we are made regenerate of the Holy Ghost. Therefore, in joyful obedience to thy Son, we bring into his fellowship them that come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we beseech thee, by thy Holy Spirit, that those here cleansed from sin and made regenerate may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior, to whom, to thee, and the same Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Name this child.
Sophie.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. We receive this child into the congregation of Christ's flock, and do sign her with the Holy Cross. In token that hereafter she may not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified, and manfully to fight under his banner against sin, the world, and the devil, and to continue Christ's faithful soldier and servant unto her life's end.
Amen.
Time we prepare to use oil of chrism. The two oils that we use are the oil of catechumen, which we use before the water rite. We do the water rite, then we do the oil of chrism. Now these three oils, as you know, were all consecrated by the bishops together during Holy Week. And they represent the presence of the bishop, obviously, who consecrates oils. Only bishops, by the way, are really allowed to consecrate oils. In some traditions, in the second largest communion, this is called chrismation. By the Holy Ghost in baptism, and marked as Christ's own. Now and forever.
Amen.
We give you this
white vesture for a token of the innocency bestowed upon thee, and for a sign to give thyself to pureness of living, that after this transitory life thou mayest be made partaker of life eternal. Luz de Cristo. See?
The light of Christ.
There's Christ.
Receive the light of Christ, and the bridegroom comes, and may go forth, meeting with all the saints. See to it that thou dost keep the grace of thy baptism. Let
Amen.
Us pray. We most heartily thank thee, O Heavenly Father, that by water and Holy Spirit thou hast bestowed upon this thy servant the forgiveness of sin, hath raised her in the life of grace. Sustain her, O Lord, and the Holy Spirit give her an inquiring and a discerning the courage to will, to persevere, a spirit to know and to love thee in thy works. Let us welcome the newly baptized.
We receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified. Proclaim his resurrection and share with us in his eternal priesthood.
Thank you.
flowers at the altar today that are in memory of our beloved Ken Moss on his early birthday, and we remember the entire Moss family at this time. Simply, every event after death for each one of us brings back pretty happy memories, but the sadness of missing someone. So please keep all of your family members in prayer. Please also note that if somebody out there who's watching today would like to give flowers some Sunday, we're not an exclusive club here. So you're more than welcome to participate in that way by offering that up if you wish. Other than that, there are no additional announcements at this time. And everybody in the church and outside the walls every morning, 9:38. Pray, brethren, that this my sacrifice of yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord receive this sacrifice at thy hands, to the praise and glory of his name, both to our benefit and that of all of his holy church.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
merciful Father, to hear us of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these, thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, if we receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, made partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy Father, and goodness, firstly, to accept this our sacrifice, praise, and thanksgiving. Death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy own church name tender remission of our sins and all the benefits of his passion. And here we offer present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, living sacrifice unto thee, humbly seeking thee. We and all those who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, may one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. Remember also, Lord, thy servants and handmaids who have gone before us with the sign of faith, our rest and sleep and peace. Remember especially Ken and Sylvia. And these will be to grant a place of refreshment, of light, and peace. And although we are unworthy for our manifold sins and often be any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, and to command these our prayers and supplications for the ministry of thy holy angels, to be brought into thy holy tabernacle before the sight of thy divine majesty, not laying our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee. O Father, almighty, world without end.
Amen.
Let us pray. And now, as the Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him that taketh away the sin of the world. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof.
But speak the word of me, and my soul shall be healed.
Lord, I am not worthy.
is my strong rock and my defense, my Savior, my God, and my Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and
ever-living God,
we most heartily thank thee,
for thou hast vouchsafed to feed us, who have really received these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and thus assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us. And we are very members of corporate and musical body of our Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs to the hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee in the Holy Ghost, be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Grant, we beseech thee, O Lord, that the sacrament which we have received may cleanse us and free thy servants from all stain of sin, that those whose consciences by guilt are accused may enjoy the fullness of the heavenly remedy. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with thee in the unity of the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Now, peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be with you and remain with you always. Not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the truth.
us prayer requests, send us needs, concerns that are on your heart and mind. If we're in this together, God will.